It's the second in our collaboration with the Berry Center for Buddhist Studies out there in Berry. And we've done a variety of collaborative things with them over the years, taking ourselves out there, teaching out there. We had a program with our students out there for a while. And so we're just trying to put together another opportunity to scheme and conspire to bring more people to the valley. And so I wasn't here, I was out of the country, but it was in November, I think, and Stephen Batchelor came and talked. The idea is sort of that when people are coming into the Berry Center for Buddhist Studies, if it works within their teaching schedule, then we can kind of piggyback on that and bring them out here. So we did that, not quite so much with William, since he lives up the road and is easily coming and going between here and there, but he is teaching out there next week. So, and then we have one more in April, Akin Chao, who's coming, and we'll have more information about that. We have a Facebook page, Smith College Buddhist Studies Facebook page, and there's also our website. All of these events are always videotaped. All of the ones from last year's speakers are also videotaped, and they're all up there on our websites, as well as other announcements about other events. But first, I'm going to introduce Musum, who is the director of the Berry Center for Buddhist Studies, senior scholar, wise guy, and many other things, especially a dear friend and a colleague. So.
In the last few days, I've been thinking that if Donald Trump gets elected, no Muslims will be allowed back in the country, and chances are that no Buddhists will be allowed back in the country.
Thanks.
Chances are that Smith College will not be able to offer this Buddhism 101 programs that we all are here. So we should enjoy these programs.
Well, vote for Bernie.
I'm happy to say a few words about the Berry Center for Buddhist Studies, despite what the future might bring in the person of Donald Trump. For the last 25 years or so, we have been doing this experiment of a different kind in Buddhist thought and practice, which is not really being done any place in the country, which is to bring the best of the university textual studies and the practice of the monastery, and to bring them together in short formats, sometimes a weekend, sometimes a five-day program, really intended program, so that different people from different kind of practice traditions could come together and work with different kinds of teachers. It's a very small town in central Massachusetts, in a farmland setting, but within the confines of a forest. And people who have come out here deeply enjoy the quiet and the solitude of the place. So we have programs every weekend, and people like William Edelglass is going to teach a weekend program. Please check the website. But the idea is that you can come in there and engage with the teachers in some kind of extensive, intensive textual study, have a conversation about a particular text or a particular tradition of Buddhist studies, and really expand your understanding of the Buddhist tradition, if that's what you're interested in. So it's a very wide-ranging offerings that we do, and it's open to anybody who wants to come in. There are no prerequisites of any kind. As Jimmy mentioned, that we did this collaboration with Smith College for 3 years, and this was another program offered for the undergraduates. Next year, we are thinking of offering a four-module Nalanda programs, which would be open to public and cover the entire range of the Buddhist historical and doctrinal tradition. So there's a lot going on, and in the spirit of investigation, examination, open-mindedness, so please check the website, and hope to see you some of you here. Okay. Good.
So we'll start.
So our speaker tonight, William Edelglass,
He's actually been collaborating with us for some time, mostly with Jay Garfield. They have two books that they've co-authored, as well as a new, more recent book out on environmental issues, right? So he comes to us with a background in philosophy and in Buddhist studies, of course, but many other kinds of interests. What's the course you're doing over at BCB? Isn't this, you know, poetry and stuff?
It's poetry and stuff.
There you go. So you maybe can say that. Anyways, welcome. Thanks for coming down.
Thanks. It's really a pleasure to be here. Smith is one of the great Buddhist studies programs anywhere. And I used to come down for some of the faculty seminars, but my wife and I have been building a house for a number of years, and building gardens, and that takes up a little bit more time. And I'm particularly happy that a woofer, any of you know the woofing program, who woofed with us last summer is here, Deneen. And another one who's coming up over the Smith spring break is here. So I'm particularly pleased with that. So some of you may be familiar with Gretchen Rubin's book, The Happiness Project. She devoted a year to doing research on what people say about what makes us happy, and then trying to implement that in her own life, and then writing a book about it. As you can see from the upper quote, when she tells people that, the first thing they say is, oh, are you studying Buddhism? Second thing they say is, are you drinking a bottle of wine every night? And the book that they recommend most often is the Dalai Lama's The Art of Happiness. So there's a great deal of social psychology which suggests that being religious or religious involvement somehow makes you happier. But in recent years, a lot of people have come to believe that there's something in particular about Buddhism that makes us happier, that's different from just being religious. I happened to get a bunch of stitches out earlier today, and the nurse, when I told her that I studied Buddhism, she said, oh, Buddhism's about kindness and happiness. And that was her impression about Buddhism. So you can see in the lower quote, the friend says to Gretchen Rubin's, I can't believe you're not practicing meditation if you're interested in happiness. So I think this way of thinking about Buddhism is relatively new. In the 19th and 20th centuries, a lot of Western interest in Buddhism was primarily because of what were taken to be its profound metaphysical views, or its ethical practice, or its depth of meditation. And I would say that in the last couple decades, at least in Western Buddhism, there's been what I would like to call a happiness turn. And you can see that in a lot of the books that are published on Buddhism. Here are two of my favorite titles: Buddhism for Busy People, Finding Happiness in an Uncertain World, and perhaps my favorite title, It's Easier Than You Think, The Buddhist Way to Happiness. So you see this in books written for a popular audience. You also see this with Dharma teachers. This is Thanissaro Bhikkhu. The practice of the Buddha's teaching, he writes, can be called the serious pursuit of true happiness, with the emphasis on serious and the true. Serious not in the sense of grim, but in the sense of sincere, unwilling to settle for anything less than genuine. True here means a happiness that doesn't change, a happiness that doesn't let you down. Implicit in this account is what I'd like to call the figure of the happy Buddhist. And I take the meaning of the happy Buddhist to be that if you are a diligent and good Buddhist, you will be happy. And if you Google the happiest man in the world, as I did last week, you will get as good an image as any, I think, of the figure of the happy Buddhist. So perhaps you can already tell by this term that I feel ambivalent about the happy Buddhist discourse with all the scientific evidence that it works. And my purpose today then will be both to suggest why one might think that some Buddhist meditation practices could increase happiness, but also to unpack in various ways the close connection that's asserted between Buddhism and happiness. And because much of the discourse, the contemporary discourse on the happy Buddhist, is grounded in psychology, I'll begin by talking about two primary methods used to measure happiness and the two conceptions of happiness that are implicit in them, namely happiness as positive affect and happiness as satisfaction with life. and then review some of the reasons that psychologists associate Buddhist-inspired meditation and increased happiness. Then, drawing explicitly on Shantideva, an 8th century Indian Buddhist thinker, and also inspired by the work of Martha Nussbaum and Emmanuel Levinas, I'll then suggest that the conceptions of happiness that are employed in these experiments are not adequate accounts of a good life, and especially not adequate accounts of a good Buddhist life, at least as Shantideva understands them, though I think more generally as well. Finally, I'll situate the claim that Buddhist awakening is a form of lasting happiness in the broader discourse on happiness, and suggest that we should be cautious about framing the goal of the Buddhist path as happiness. So, our word happiness is from the Middle English word hap, which means what happens, or chance, or luck, or fortune. So we get the words happenstance, or perhaps, or haphazard, or hapless. And you see the same etymological connection between luck and happiness in a lot of Indo-European languages. If you think of Glück, the German word, means both luck and happiness. Darren McMahon, in A History of Happiness, characterizes this view as the tragic view of happiness. That is, here's Oedipus, who kills his father in self-defense and sleeps with his mother, not through any bad or vicious character, but simply because he has bad luck. So the tragic view of happiness is not what people have in mind when they talk about Buddhism and happiness. The happy Buddhist discourse presupposes the idea that we have some significant control over how happy we are, and in particular, that we can meditate and increase our happiness. And indeed, this is the idea that you see widely in positive psychology, and their fellow travelers, what's called the new science of happiness, that has so powerfully legitimated the happy Buddhist discourse. So many positive psychologists have this view that 50% of our happiness is dependent on our genetic tendencies. That is, we have a set point or adaptation level. After you're really happy or really sad, eventually you come back to this level. 10% has to do with external circumstances, and 40% has to do with the choices we make in the course of our day or the course of our lives. So positive psychologists then are interested in figuring out what are the choices that we can make to make us happier, and then writing about it in books that sell extremely well, that disseminate the science of happiness and how to be happy. Clearly, they do not have a tragic view of happiness. The work presupposes that we can choose to be happy, take the appropriate actions, and then be happy. So I'd like to make one quick note about terminology here, and that is that a lot of positive psychologists also use the term subjective well-being, though, as you can see, not in the titles of their books. And the happiness discourse in Buddhism almost always uses the word happiness, and I'm going to stick with happiness throughout my talk. So for the new science of happiness to actually be scientific, it needed to develop methods of measuring our happiness so we could learn who was happy and why and how to become happier. And there, as I was saying before, there are two dominant conceptions of happiness in this work. One is positive affect, and the other is being satisfied with one's life. So I'm going to go through both of these now. So here in the life satisfaction theory, happiness is determined by a self-reported cognitive evaluation of how satisfied you are with your life. In contrast to the classical Greeks, and I think many Buddhists, who generally understood there to be an objective goal that was grounded in human nature, that was a goal for our lives, and people like Martha Nussbaum defend today. Most positive psychologists, such as Ed Diener, who put together this questionnaire, take an approach that they characterize as more democratic, and they simply ask people the degree to which they are satisfied with their lives. For Diener and many other psychologists then, measuring life satisfaction is measuring happiness. It's a great phrase that is used, that satisfaction with life is a proxy for chronic happiness. So if you look at this questionnaire, your total score on this would be the precise measurement of your happiness. But there are critics of the life satisfaction approach to measuring happiness who argue that retrospective self-reports are often unduly influenced by contingent or irrelevant conditions. So you can think of the mood you're in or the weather. The weather often affects how satisfied we are with our lives. So Daniel Kahneman, for example, in an article he titles Objective Happiness, says that if you really want to compare happiness levels, you need to ask people at a lot of different times during the day and during the year. And he and many other researchers, at least the ones who can afford it, it's obviously more expensive than life satisfaction questionnaires, give people handheld devices through which they can be contacted at random times during the day and asked to fill out a survey of their current feelings on something like this. So according to Kahneman, happiness can be objectively measured simply because at any given moment, we're constantly evaluating on a good, bad, hedonic scale our affects. How are we feeling right now? And so the conception of happiness that is implicit in this kind of a measurement can be understood as an affect-based theory of happiness. That is, it has to do with positive feelings or positive emotions. And the happier you are is primarily determined by the intensity and duration of the positive feelings that you have. So having sketched out these two theories then, I'm going to briefly move to the results, which you can probably imagine. If you're in this room, you might have some sense of Buddhism and mindfulness and happiness. And it turns out that mindfulness-based interventions are often correlated with increased life satisfaction. So mindfulness has been shown to reduce depression, reduce the misuse of alcohol, anxiety, chronic pain, et cetera, improves relationships, increases the acceptance of life circumstances. And there was a 2010 study that said that after a mere 3 sessions of mindfulness, you are more satisfied with your life. And happiness is often said to be in an inverse relationship to perceived discrepancies that one has. So the reduced desire discrepancy is a reduction of the discrepancy between what you have and what you desire, and then between what you had in the past and what you have now, and between what you have now and what you think that other people have who are in a comparable relevant group. So it should be clear from this that mindfulness does increase our satisfaction with our lives. Going now to a study done with experience sampling, a positive affect theory of happiness. This is perhaps the study that is most often cited, at least I hear most often cited by people in the Buddhist world, to suggest that happiness and mindfulness are correlated. So this was a study done by Matt Killingsworth and Dan Gilbert with many thousands of people. They gave these handheld devices to, and they were spread throughout the world, different ages, different occupations. And at random times, they asked them these 3 questions. What are you doing? What are you thinking about? And how happy are you? And as anybody who has ever tried to meditate can imagine, much of the time, people are not thinking about what they're doing. But what really interested many people in the Dharma world, in the Buddhist meditation world, was that there was a strong correlation between thinking about what you were doing at any given time and being happy. So Killingsworth and Gilbert titled one of the publications that came out of this study, A Wandering Mind is an Unhappy Mind. So to the degree that Buddhism, as understood in the broader cultural context today is mindfulness meditation. To that degree, Buddhism would seem to suggest that it increases our positive affect and thereby increases our happiness. So in addition to these studies, there are studies on compassion and happiness. So there are many Buddhist traditions that have compassion meditations, and that is said to increase our happiness according to these studies. What has received perhaps the most publicity are studies done especially by Richie Davidson in Wisconsin, but other people as well, that suggest that with new imaging technologies, somehow there are neurobiological correlates of happiness that have been measured in meditators. So, I've been giving some of the psychology that is used to justify the belief in the happy Buddhist, and I've argued that there are two conceptions of happiness that underlie this psychology: the positive affect theory of happiness and the life satisfaction theory of happiness. And I am now going to critique them. I want to make clear, though, that especially to the degree that they both seem to reduce suffering, I think they're a great thing, both from a Buddhist perspective, but who doesn't want more life satisfaction and more positive affect? I'm not arguing that we shouldn't have more of that. And I want to make one other prefatory comment, and that is that in positive psychology, you often hear people say that morality and meaning are associated with happiness. I just want to point out that, in fact, the studies that are done are studies about positive affect and life satisfaction. So I'm now going to move to something of a critique. So the first question I want to address is whether our primary concern should be maximizing positive affects. That is, whether this is a decent candidate for the goal of our lives. And this is from chapter 6 of a book by Shantideva, The Way of the Bodhisattva, An Introduction to the Way of the Bodhisattva, where he says, "Just as there is no mental pleasure in all sensual gratification whatsoever when one's body is on fire, likewise there is no way for the compassionate ones to be happy when sentient beings are in pain." Here's a similar sentiment from another text. Tathagatas are Buddhas. Here it says, "Tathagatas have sympathy for the innumerable living beings that are continuously struck by the poisonous arrows of their various states of existence. This is why I refer to the Tathagata as having sorrow." So this is the Buddha responding to a question in the Mahaparinirvana Sutra. It's not too much of a stretch to interpret Shantideva as saying that the more we pay attention to sentient beings, the more pain that we see. And for Shantideva, how we think and how we feel are inextricable. Thus, to see the pain of others is precisely not to feel happy. According to the positive affect conception of happiness, the more pleasant feelings you have, the happier and better your life. And who doesn't want pleasant feelings? But there may be good reasons to think that a life devoid of unpleasant feelings, including grief and sadness, maybe anger, may be lacking in important ways. For many philosophers, I take it, emotions are appraisals of events. This was true of Hellenistic thinkers, certainly some Hellenistic thinkers. It's true of Hume, of Heidegger, and I think people like Sean Nichols or Joshua Green, contemporary moral psychologists, defend a similar view. And I think this is a view that you can find in Shantideva, that our thoughts and feelings are not absolutely separable. I think of the Dalai Lama, who, when greeting recent refugee arrivals from Tibet, often cries when he hears their stories. If we only felt positive affects, I think Shantideva is suggesting, we would be blind to suffering, we'd be missing something morally important. So, of course, the positive psychologists are right that we ought to feel, that it's good to feel plenty of joy and optimism and gratitude in our lives for all that's good and for future possibilities. And I certainly think that our lives are better when we feel these. But should we primarily be focusing on cultivating these positive affects? Or do we also need to focus on cultivating the kinds of feelings that arise when you are confronted by racism or environmental degradation or war or poverty or other evils? I would suggest that Shantideva thinks we should be open to those, and I would side with him. So another question I have is whether or not an objective happiness hedonic scale might obscure differences that are important in understanding our lives. So again, going back to Shantideva, he says, one should diligently apply oneself to the action in which one engages. Intoxicated by that action, one should be of an insatiable mind, like one striving for the satisfaction of the result of a game. I take him to be saying here that we should take pleasure in cultivating the perfections of a bodhisattva, not unlike Aristotle's account in the Nicomachean Ethics that a virtuous person takes pleasure in virtuous action. That is, I don't think Shantideva is in any way saying pleasure is bad. But while pleasure itself is not bad, taking pleasure in some things is problematic. He says, if attraction does not arise due to a naturally foul smell, is that not good? Why do people take pleasure in what is worthless and anoint it with fragrance? Here Shantideva seems to be suggesting that there are qualitative differences between various pleasures. And I take this to be very different from Kahneman's account, in which objective happiness is constituted by discrete moments of pleasure, regardless of what the pleasurable activity actually is. So it's this understanding of pleasurable activity as a sensation that can be compared on the basis of duration and intensity that's suggested by Killingsworth and Gilbert in the image that accompanies their famous study that mindfulness is correlated with happiness. Implicit in this image, as I take it, is the idea that one can map out hedonic feelings on one scale, whether it be the pleasures of shopping or doing housework or reading or playing or praying or making love. And making this explicit can lead to other reasonable conclusions from this study. I've heard plenty of friends in the Buddhist world refer to this study as it seems to justify meditation on the promise of happiness. But for some reason, I haven't heard anyone say what it seems to show most clearly, which is that sex makes us significantly happier than anything else we do. Perhaps you may not need a social scientist to tell you that. But for Shantideva, this is the main point I want to make, it's preferable to suffer some pains than to feel some pleasures. And if feelings such as pleasure and pain are ways of attending to the world, which I take Shantideva to be suggesting, that pleasure and pain are ways in which we attend to the world more generally, but to sentient beings, to others, then are we losing something important when the nuance and richness and diversity of pain and pleasure are mapped onto one scale? So moving on to the life satisfaction theory of happiness. I wonder what Shantideva and others committed to the bodhisattva ideal, the aspiration of alleviating suffering from sentient beings, might say about what satisfaction discloses about our lives. Here, as a reminder to some of you, and perhaps new to others, is at least one expression that I really like of the bodhisattva ideal. May I be a protector for those who are without protectors, a guide for travelers, and a boat, a bridge, and a ship for those who wish to cross over. May I be a lamp for those who seek light, a bed for those who seek rest, and may I be a servant for all beings who desire a servant. And because I really like this one, this is a contemporary ecological articulation of the traditional Zen vows by the American poets Allen Ginsberg, Philip Whalen, and Gary Snyder. Sentient beings are numberless. I vow to save them. Consuming dire desires are endless. I vow to stop them. Bio relations are intricate. I vow to honor them. Nature's way is beautiful. I vow to become it. So I take it that these are not particularly easily realized vows. Shantideva says, to realize these takes oceans of aeons. So what would it mean to be satisfied with our lives when there are so many sentient beings who need us, I take Shantideva to suggest, especially if we find ourselves occupying positions of privilege that rely on the sufferings of others. And while it's true that a vast majority of us say that we are satisfied, there are some people in our society who are much more satisfied than others. This is Sue Halpern reviewing a lot of the positive psychology in an article in the New York Review of Books, where she says, "The researchers also know from their surveys that the happiest of happy Americans are Republican social butterflies and bigots." There's no reason that these people shouldn't be happy, but it is curious if you look at who are the happy people. Alan Carr, who's another positive psychologist, I put the cover of his book up on an earlier slide, he says that overall, the happiest people in our society tend to be white, they tend to be politically right of center, they're conservatives, and they tend to be people who have enough economic power that they feel in control of their lives and do not feel financially stressed. So you can understand perhaps why they might be satisfied. They don't see, perhaps, I don't want to paint with too broad a brush, but one could imagine somebody suggesting that they don't see too much of a need to change the status quo. They may not be a group of people discomforted by the sufferings of others, saying to themselves, sentient beings are numberless, I vow to save them. So one wonders then if satisfaction with life is necessarily a feeling we always ought to have. It's hard for me to imagine Dorothy Day or any number of writers, artists, civil rights leaders, great politicians, or aspiring bodhisattvas, or you can have your own list, the people who did great work but may not have felt satisfied in the doing of that work. That is, may not have felt that their life was already satisfied, and that's part of what motivates them. In a world of numberless sentient beings and work to be done, is it so bad if you don't feel satisfied with what you have done so far in your life when you know there's more to do? That is, I take this as the kind of claim that Levinas is making when he says that if you have a good conscience, you may not be paying enough attention. Obviously, he says that in a book-length form. But if you aspire to liberate sentient beings from suffering, that is, if you are a bodhisattva, it seems you are unlikely to be as satisfied as the social butterflies. So there's one other conception of happiness that is at play in the happy Buddhist discourse that seems very different from the hedonic scale and life satisfaction theories. And that's the theory of happiness that I mentioned earlier in the words of Tanisaro Bhikkhu. It's a lasting, enduring happiness that in fact is the goal of the path. It's permanent, it doesn't change. Here's Mathieu Ricard writing recently, sukha, so the opposite of dukkha. So happiness as opposed to dissatisfaction or suffering is therefore a state of lasting well-being that manifests itself when we have freed ourselves of mental blindness and afflictive emotions. It is also the wisdom that allows us to see the world as it is without veils or distortions. It is finally the joy of moving towards inner freedom and the loving kindness and compassion that radiates towards others. Later in this same article, he says explicitly that awakening or liberation is happiness. And you see this in other people, Robert Thurman, the Dalai Lama. So, it's certainly the case that awakening is often characterized negatively as a liberation from ignorance, aversion, and desire. There are also plenty of accounts in traditional or Asian Buddhist texts of happiness as bliss, as luminosity, as something that you can imagine as a positive affect or as close as you can get to a positive affect. So I don't want to argue here that happiness can't be a perfectly legitimate, novel, contemporary way of characterizing awakening. I'm not arguing that it's somehow inauthentic to Buddhism. But the question I am interested in is, what are the conditions that have recently led a variety of Buddhist figures to characterize happiness as awakening, or awakening as happiness? And here, there's a great deal that's been written on happiness and on the way in which there's been a confluence, an intertwining between the rise of the therapeutic culture with consumer culture that, together with the loss of religious meaning, has left us, left many of us, with a sense that well-being, our own well-being, is everything. A desire for well-being that's kind of unmoored from something larger than ourselves. And this may be why so much is written about happiness, why we're all kind of interested in happiness. I mean, there are obviously other reasons we may be interested in happiness. Notice when I did a search on Amazon last week, Mathieu Ricard's book, which is largely on the continuity between the science of happiness and awakening as happiness, is the second text that's listed. And I saw this in the New York Times yesterday. I don't know if anybody else saw it. I couldn't resist putting it in. The United Arab Emirates has the highest building in the world, and now they want to be the happiest people in the world. So they are starting a ministry of happiness. So the main point I want to make here is that the emphasis on happiness in contemporary Buddhism is really part of a much larger phenomenon that the cultural critic Sara Ahmed describes as a happiness term. I highly recommend Sara Ahmed's book, The Promise of Happiness. According to Ahmed, happiness is now the criterion for determining the value of our lives, and our choices of activities, objects, and identities are justified to the degree that they contribute to our happiness. As Ahmed argues, marriage, optimism, and other correlates of increased happiness themselves become moral ideals. Happy ways of being are understood to be good ways of being. Optimism, then, doesn't just make us happier and healthier and more productive at work. It is now a moral ideal. Marriage doesn't just make us happier. Because it makes us happier, we ought to get married. So she takes the figure of the unhappy queer, the melancholy migrant, and what's the third one? Does anybody remember? But figures who occupy positions that our society doesn't characterize as happy. She characterizes her book as an unhappy archive. Today, for something to be good, it needs to augment our happiness. Happiness is the measure of our lives. Buddhism, like our contemporary society, now appears oriented towards happiness, and Buddhist practices are scientifically demonstrated to make us happier. So you can think of it as Buddhism, just as when it spread to new countries in Asia and provided all these worldly benefits of political power, financial success, fertility, that this is how it's able to fit the needs of a new time and a new place. So what it provides today is happiness. That's why it doesn't seem particularly strange for a well-known Buddhist teacher to be talking about happiness at a conference of the largest corporations, or some of the largest corporations in the world, the Wisdom 2.0 conference. Buddhism gives us what our therapeutic age desires. It gives happiness, or at least the dream of the possibility of happiness. So, as you can see by these pictures, I'll take a slightly different tone now. At the beginning of my talk, I said I felt some ambivalence concerning the happy Buddhist discourse, and I meant that literally. Most days, many days, I say, using contemporary words for a traditional Buddhist practice, something about generating a wish for the desire of happiness for sentient beings. And I certainly believe that increased positive affect and life satisfaction is generally a good thing. And if Buddhist-inspired practices, such as mindfulness, make this possible, I think that's great. The interest in and proliferation of mindfulness practice should be recognized as reduced suffering. There's little that's more Buddhist than that. And the amazing proliferation we've seen, given the role of science in our society, really is much more likely if happiness is something that can be measured. However, as I've argued, Shantideva's ethical concern should make us wary of an ideal grounded either in the conception of happiness as a positive affect that is measured primarily according to duration and intensity, or in the conception of happiness as a state of satisfaction with oneself and one's life circumstances. I take it Sue Halpern's example of the happy bigots would be should remind us that that's not enough. And I think looking at the contemporary discourse on happiness should make us cautious about characterizing awakening as happiness or emphasizing that too much. By saying this, I'm not suggesting that meditation isn't transformative. There's no reason not to trust one's own feelings of benefit, and there's no reason, I think, to think that the science is somehow wrong and the benefits of meditation aren't really there. And as I've been drawing on the philosophical resources of Shantideva, it's worth mentioning that he, as much as anyone, believes in the transformative power of meditation. The Bodhicharyavatara, the book I've been quoting from, is arguably a meditation manual. And I think he thinks that if you do these meditations, you will become wiser, more compassionate, more generous, and frankly, happier. But while there are Buddhists who promise a faster path, Shantideva's understanding that it takes oceans of aeons to liberate oneself from defilement seems like a reasonable assessment of our situation. From Shantideva's perspective, it seems we are unlikely to find enduring, unconditioned happiness anytime soon. Moreover, he thinks pursuing such a goal would probably be counterproductive. As Shantideva argues on several occasions, pursuing our own happiness inevitably leads to suffering as it is motivated by and reinforces a clinging to self. That doesn't mean that there aren't figures who might be many eons ahead of us on the path, and Thich Nhat Hanh or the Dalai Lama or Pema Chodron are figures who come to mind. That is, people who, in whom we may see the fruits of practice, qualities of a wise and compassionate mind, a joy and equanimity that may inspire us. But, while it would probably be plenty of fun, which I think is great, I would be cautious in following Gretchen Rubin's example and making your life into a happiness project, whether a Buddhist variety or any other. We live in a culture in which we constantly receive the message that we ought to be happy, and happy ways of being are good ways of being. And while the vast majority of us, really almost everyone, consistently tell researchers that we're happy, and we're often offended if we're accused of not being happy, what those 90,000 publications on Amazon suggest, I think, is that we may suspect we're not as happy as we feel we ought to be. And if we're not happy enough, then it's our own fault because we're not living in the right way. We're not getting enough exercise or enough sleep, or not spending enough time with friends, or we're not mindful enough or grateful enough or optimistic enough or having enough sex or meditating enough. So just to be clear, I'm not saying you shouldn't do those things. It's great to eat well and get enough sleep and be mindful and spend time with friends. I'm not saying that you shouldn't. But I do think that Shantideva's insights into impermanence and dependent origination would suggest that we are not as in control of our lives as we might think, that our bodies have their own rhythms of pleasure and pain, and that we're vulnerable to the dissatisfactions and karma, for lack of a better word, that characterize the fragility of our lives. And we would probably reduce plenty of dissatisfaction if we acknowledged, as Kant does, that while we may desire happiness, it's hard to say exactly what we're wishing for. Mostly, it seems, even as we feel positive affects and we may be satisfied with our lives, we still desire the mysterious and definite state that is somehow always elsewhere. So, since this is a talk on happiness, and to end on a lighter note, and perhaps to give you some positive affect, I have to say that having twins makes me feel as though I'm getting as close to happiness as it seems reasonable to expect in this lifetime. Thank you for your attention.
The twins almost kept him from coming down here, but we were working this out blissfully. But we have time for some questions. I'm sure there's lots of things people would like to ask us about. So.
Yeah, Maria.
So I agree with pretty much everything you say, suggest.
Do you want to stop there?
But I want to think a little bit. I mean, we're trying to start with Bhikkhu, and these folks are getting the notion that Nibbana is Sukha.
Uh-huh.
It's very much in the Pali sources.
Yeah.
And it's pretty interesting how the Buddha will say stuff, really interesting stuff about Sukha. So, you know, there's this moment when she's sitting under the when he was a young man, and remembering this after he became enlightened, right before he became enlightened, he has this moment of sitting under a tree and having a moment in which he thought, why am I afraid of that sukha that has nothing to do with sensual pleasure? Mm-hmm. And the next thought is, I am not afraid of that sukha that has nothing to do. So he was trying to think about a kind of happiness that isn't about positive affect.
Yeah.
Right? And so I wonder if you, so when you were moving into Shantideva, it was, what is the good life consist of? But I wonder if you have tried to think about maybe the Buddhist sources can tell us about some other kind of happiness that isn't positive affect or life satisfaction. That ground up, we would be getting a different conception of happiness that is not being considered in positive psychology or much any other place. And not a good life, a moral,
yeah,
but a happiness,
yeah,
that isn't part of our imagination, you know, modern,
yeah,
discourse imagination about it.
Well, two things. One is, I do think, I mean, you know way more about the sources than I do, the early texts, and I certainly think that there are plenty of places where you get something like happiness as the goal in what we think of as traditional Buddhist texts. And you had said that you're thinking about happiness now, and that sounds like a great project for you to pursue. I don't have a whole lot to say about it. I feel like my interest here is arising primarily from a certain discomfort that I have on the way that Buddhism and happiness is talked about. And so much of this is critical. And I think there's a lot of work to be done that would flesh it out. But I also wonder if the word happiness isn't already so contaminated in contemporary discourse. I think of, you know, the Templeton Foundation is funding this work that's based at Yale that trying to move towards joy. I don't know that that would really do it, but in some sense we have to, just like dukkha is often not translated as suffering anymore, but dissatisfaction or disease or whatever, in some ways sukha may need another set of words to be translated as rather than happiness. I mean, I don't know, what do you think?
Well, I think that there's a ton of words for joy and happiness. Piti, samanasa, sukha, you know, there's a lot, and the early sources are teeming with a huge vocabulary,
yeah,
of happiness and joy and pleasure. And, you know, Padmanabhani is a really interesting argument where he wants to, I don't think this is quite right, but it's interesting where he argues that why, one of the reasons that Buddha was so successful is because he's creating a huge lexicon of happiness,
mm-hmm,
and giving people names or possible kinds of experiences that wasn't on the ground before. Now, I think actually all of these guys in the earliest days of being represented as standing around arguing about happiness,
mm-hmm,
and joy and human experience at this kind of level. The Upanishads are full of language,
yeah,
but they're using somewhat different language. So they're trying to figure out, like, what do all, you know, where does sukha sometimes just means pleasure, the opposite of dukkha.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's, you know, and the Buddha's very deliberately playing on all this stuff.
Yeah.
They say stuff like, you know, what you guys call dukkha, we call sukha, right? And what you guys call sukha, we call dukkha. You know, and they have, you know, so he's deliberately playing with these ideas. And in one and the same sutta, you won't have happy, sukha will be pleasure in the sense of affect in one context, and it's more like bliss,
yeah,
in another. So it's really,
yeah, and I think you could probably see that in later texts, like the Mahaparinibbana Sutra, which says, so one of the four cardinal errors in early Buddhism is sometimes said to be, well, taking what is really suffering and thinking it's happiness. But it's also said that it's also perverse to take what is happiness and think that it's suffering. And so it's not just the early texts. I think there are a lot of places where fleshing out what that might mean would be a great project today, but I haven't really seen anybody do it. Maybe there's a book for you. Yeah, so.
I mean, this is kind of, you kind of have answered my question with the last couple sentences that you said, but what about the people who say, you know, I don't need those 9,800 books on happiness. I feel that I'm truly happy. I'm giving compassion. I'm, you know, loving kindness. I'm meditating each day. but yet I still have sensual desires. I still have these cheap thrills that I get from life. And those constitute my happiness that I feel that is true. So then if in the Buddhist ideal, is that enough? Are they happiest doing what they're doing right now, even though they're still engaged in sensual pleasures? Or would they be even happier without knowing it, or with knowing it, if they were to not have those sensual cheap thrills mm-hmm. and stick strictly to dharma and moral and ethical practice of Buddhism?
So I think there are probably many different Buddhist ideals. For Shantideva, a Buddhist ideal would have to include moral behavior and a concern with taking pleasure in some things rather than other things. For the positive psychologist, what you're suggesting, I take it, if it increases positive affect or you have an increased life satisfaction, then you're simply happier. And what I'm trying to argue is that for Buddhism, at least a kind of constructed Buddhism that I'm drawing on Shantideva for, that wouldn't be the case. Yeah, so 1, 2, and 3. Yeah.
I just wanted to make sure a comment about the dukkha. I always think of dukkha as constituting something like angst, maybe in a higher mm-hmm. sense, and not having migraine headache or losing your money on the stock market. I think a deeper sense. And so when usually dukkha is just translated as suffering, and I think that's like a wrong way of looking at it.
Yeah.
Well, I just had a question about the studies to do with positive affect and the extent to which they are aware of or admit the cultural relativity of the affects that are deemed positive. And I say that because in the Chinese Buddhist context, for example, there is very little emphasis on words denoting happiness as such, or to put it another way, the emphasis is on the cultivation of qualities such as harmony, a sense of unity of being, of ordered action, etc., serenity, peace. And although those are qualities that we, that Western psychologists would typically associate mm-hmm. with states of happiness, those are nevertheless quite different from the on the scale where sex is by far the happiness to making thing, right? Mm-hmm. And so I just wondered to what extent those studies actually take cultural factors into account.
So by this time, there are many, many millions of people who've been given a questionnaire that's derived from Ed Diener's work all around the world. And one of the things that they like to say is that it's fairly consistent, whether it's Inuit in Greenland or wherever, Japan, Kenya, people generally suggest that they're happier than one might otherwise think. However, there are some who do talk about the differences between, say, Japanese cultures and Western cultures regarding what would lead them to think of themselves as being happy, whether they're part of a group. You can't be happy if you're not part of a group or something like that. But one of Ed Diener's emphases is you have to be democratic. There can't be anything normative, and you just have to ask people if they think of themselves as satisfied with their lives or happy with their lives or not. And that's the only thing you can do, regardless of what culture they're in, what cultural differences there may be. Does that get at your...
Sure.
Was there something?
I suppose one question is asking people how happy they're feeling, but another question is to ask them, what the second point that you were just making is, what are the reasons for that, right? And then, given that this is a talk also on kind of Buddhist constructions of happiness, the extent to which qualities that Shantideva is talking about, such as awareness of suffering, can nevertheless mm-hmm. be classed as a happy life, as a mm-hmm. Buddhist fulfilled life, as mm-hmm. a satisfactory life.
Yeah. I mean, somebody I think who's helpful here is Susan Wolfe. I don't know if anybody's read Meaning in Life and Why It Matters, the Tanner lectures from a few years ago. And she makes a nice distinction between meaning, happiness, and morality, and trying to think of them as separate and how they fit together. And probably a lot of the work on Buddhism and happiness would benefit from doing something like that. Yeah.
So I guess I'll start with saying that metta, we always say, may I be happy. So it's a core tenet of Buddhist practice. You know, when you look at the world, you see it in two ways, and I think the reality of this moment and all of us standing here and the not real reality of the fact that we are all constantly changing, we don't recognize that this as we go along, but that is truly what's happening. And so if we take those two pieces together, we can develop, I think, a sense of what we are to ourselves and everything else. And Joseph Goldstein did a great talk on worldly and pleasant, unpleasant, and neutral, and then unworldly, mm-hmm. pleasant, unpleasant, neutral. And the happiness and joy of pleasant is from the sense of knowing all of that together, you know, that you are part of this, but we are impermanent. Mm-hmm. And there's a sense of, I guess, joy that comes from that feeling that we can gather from, and that is a happiness. So it may not be the same happiness as, you know, life satisfaction, because there's dukkha to that, or there will be dukkha, because it'll never be permanent. Mm-hmm. So I just throw that out there.
Yeah, thank you. Are there other comments or questions? Jamie?
Like you, I've watched, I think like all of us, we've been watching the, I call it the happiness industry.
Yeah.
We've all been watching that and the Buddhism, various strands of Buddhism coming together. And I have lots of misgivings. I tend, oddly, to come down on the side of Buddhism life uh-huh. in this operation. You know, it seems to me that a lot of the conversation, the two things that come up, you know, subjective reporting, and, you know, Buddhists is just going to say, well, as they always do, you don't know what you're talking about. That's not lasting happiness, Jane. Mm. That's not permanent happiness, Jane. That's happiness that's, in fact, in one of your quotes, happiness that's subject to change. Mm-hmm. And then they'll very quickly stop talking about it. Because if the Buddhist goes that way, you know, they're into some areas that the scientist will never go.
Yeah.
They have to get into something about some luminescent originally pure mind, or they have to get into
something
some
that's unconditioned nature. By.
And yeah, unconditioned. Nibbana is one yeah. of the first unconditioned elements, right?
Yeah.
And that's not going to get much play out there, you know, in the world of this dialogue mm-hmm. that's going on. So then, you know, when you're at that point, and then you're also at the point of saying, well, you're having a good time. You have some joyous moments there. The kids are doing well so far. Yeah, there's going to be some other stuff that's going to come up in it. But as you said from those, from Ed Denier's studies, and this has been going on all over the world for so long, you know, most people, even in the most miserable places, report themselves mm-hmm. 60-65% of the time content, satisfied. 15% of the time really doing well.
Yeah.
And they are all over the world, right? So then, without a possible response of rebirth, well, Jamie, that's all cool and fine and good. You've got a fat life this time, but just wait. Mm. You know, you're going to hit your comeuppance. You'll fall down from the Deva Loka, and you'll end up, you know. And so then, you know, I have either the choice. Actually, I have lots of choices. But by and large, it seems to me that kind of the Buddhism light works. Yeah, a little bit of meditation is good for you. It's always good to sit down and chill out a bit, be nicer to the people around you, you know, try to avoid evil, and do more good, and purify your mind, do. But I wouldn't check myself into monastic robes on a mountainside, giving up the ice cream cones and sex.
I mean, one of my favorite verses in Shantideva is where he says, if you want to cultivate generosity, you should start with giving away vegetables. And then you'll be able to give away your body. And the reason I take that to be so important is that from Shantideva's perspective, you shouldn't practice generosity to the degree that you feel resentment. You should be practicing generosity at the stage that you're at. And frankly, this is why I think he thinks it takes oceans of eons to achieve liberation. Most of us are not at the point that we're that far beyond Buddhism light in a way. And so, I mean, my last section was saying something along the lines of what you're saying, and that is that we're unlikely to reach enlightenment anytime soon, and that to the degree that you feel this pressure to always be kind of obsessively working on yourself, always be trying to attain a happiness that may not be, that I think is kind of a mysterious state that is always beyond us, that probably is not all that healthy for us. But we have a meditation room at our house, and we have a group of neighbors who come over many days and sit with us, and it's an important part of my life. Yeah, Jay.
First, just thanks for a fabulous talk and a really nice discussion.
Thanks.
Some
pleasures are good, some pleasures are bad.
I never quite know, and I've never had quite a grip on what the English word happiness means. It's just so weird. But of course, some people, and I'm not one of them, like to translate eudaimonia as happiness. And that got me thinking about the structure of your analysis and book one of the Nicomachean Ethics, particularly the beginning of the function argument.
Uh-huh.
Because, you know, Aristotle very quickly dismisses both of the views that you're dismissing in roughly the same way. Pleasure can't possibly be happiness, but it's a life of cattle, cattle. Can't be eudaimonia, can't be doing well. And of course, he's also pointing out the need normative dimension, thinking about this very idea that you could discuss human well-being and divorce it from normativity is bizarre. But the second one, of course, the important one there, is honor. And honor, of course, he says, depends more upon those who confer it than upon those upon whom it's conferred. And one way to think about satisfaction is self-honoring, right? So when you think about desire satisfaction and being satisfied with one's own life, you're thinking, do I give myself the grade? And then you recognize that there's a terrible circularity there, and again, you're divorcing the normative dimension of doing well, living well.
Yeah.
So this is not meant to say, gee, we should opt for an Aristotelian understanding of Sukha. Though there are certainly some people who argue with that, and does that very persuasively. But just to say that there's a nice homology between what you've been doing and what happens at the beginning of the functional argument, and so it's always worth going back to Aristotle and the Stoics to remind ourselves that we don't really know what the word happiness means.
So, the last few weeks, as I've been working on this, I've also been teaching the Nicomachean Ethics and Epictetus. So it's been very much with me. I'm sympathetic to Aristotle. I'm sympathetic to a lot of what Martha Nussbaum says about this. And Martha Nussbaum is the person who's most present behind what I'm doing. And I think one of the differences between the positive psychologists and people like Nussbaum, Shantideva, and Aristotle is precisely the issue of normativity. Psychologists,
Marcus Aurelius,
the positive psychologists, and my sense is psychologists in general, and if anybody here might be able to say more about this to correct me, please do, they are much less willing than philosophers to make normative claims, because they want to ask, well, what's the basis of this normative claim? Why is this account of human nature one that has norms embedded in it? And perhaps being a philosopher, I'm much more willing to make those sorts of normative claims. But I think Shantideva, and honestly, the what I think of as the kind of the Indian and Tibetan tradition of Buddhist ethics is making a claim about human nature that grounds norms. Yeah. Yeah, so the question was, ought we to be asking questions to determine politics based on happiness? And my favorite example of why we shouldn't is, I don't know if you know Derek Bach, he was the longtime former president of Harvard. He wrote a book called The Politics of Happiness, in which, and his wife also actually wrote a book on happiness. They were working on it at the same time, a different book. And Derek Bach says, well, okay, all this happiness research tells us an enormous amount in very detailed ways. For example, we're happier when we get more sleep. Let's set up, especially for teenagers, let's set up school hours so that they can get more sleep. But it also turns out that income inequality does not make us less happy. If there are people who are filthy rich and a lot of other people who aren't, that doesn't really matter to our happiness. And there have been critiques of that book based on just the kind of suggestion that you're making, that there may be issues of justice and morality that would trump, not to use, that would trump questions of happiness, that happiness should not be the measurement of our policies. So, yeah.
I'm not a Buddhist, and listening to everyone's comments, I find it interesting that there's this desire to create some sort of collective decision of what happiness actually is, and that the idea of using this as a guide for something else, I find, I'm here just because I'm curious, I find that very interesting, that is that even necessary? And if it is or is not necessary, it's going to be individual for every being that's sitting amongst us now. I don't think it's something that needs to have a real designated definition. There's this complexity of language or the philosophy of language, and if we get into all of that, it's like, you've never seen ice, tell me what ice is. You've never seen it, you have no idea, please tell me what ice is. And how would you describe to me through language what ice is? And I have no concept of ice or snow or falling from the sky, frozen water. So I just, being here and listening to everyone, it's this whole other, doesn't need to be something solid behind it. Just a comment.
Yeah, thank you for that comment.
Okay, thank you very much, William.